This shit is wicked. Get on these mean streets, mean streets. Daryl Hamo Baum might not be a household name to everybody, but if you in the streets, boxing, or hip-hop, you already know what time it is. Baum was plugged in heavy with two major names, Mike Tyson and 50 Cent. Tyson had him on deck as his bodyguard, his right hand when things got thick, but it's the connection to 50 where Baum's name hit the headlines hard. Born in BK, Baum was deep in the Brooklyn streets, surrounded by people hustling and some who took the criminal route. He played his role in both worlds, from legit security for Tyson to his alleged moves in the streets. In 2000, Daryl's name got tied to a major event that almost took 50 Cent out the game. 50, real name Curtis Jackson, caught 9 shots in a brutal hit, an attempt that could have shut down his rise before he even blew up. Word on the block is, Baum was involved in that shooting, and that's how his story and 50's got linked forever. Daryl Hamo Baum was born August 20th, 1965, right in the heart of Brooklyn. You already know, BK molded this man. The streets of Bed-Stuy, where every block got its own story. Sometimes it's all love, sometimes it's straight war zone vibes. Now, word on the street is that Baum got tied up with some real heavy hitters. Maybe got down with some crews early on. The hustle, the grind, and them street ties shaped him, no doubt. Fast forward, and his name really start ringing bells when he linked up with Mike Tyson, the champ himself. Hama wasn't just any dude in the background, though. He was Tyson's personal muscle. That connection put him right in the mix, solidified his spot in the inner circle of one of the baddest dudes in boxing. But it didn't stop there. His name got real loud when the streets and hip-hop started crossing paths heavy, especially after some serious incidents had his name in everybody's mouth. Real ones know what went down. Baum was deep in the game, tied to some real gangland legends. Sun was moving heavy in them Brooklyn streets, connected with the Supreme team and all that. Supreme McGriff, you know, top dog of that whole operation, had Hamo in the mix, Cash Money Brothers, CMB, running it like a mob, putting in work on all levels. Now, Baum wasn't just some sideline dude, he was about that action. Word was, Hamo was the one who allegedly hit 50 Cent in that infamous shooting back in 2000. 9 shots and still couldn't stop him, but it had the streets buzzing. At that time, there was mad tension in the rap game. 50 Cent had already started beefing with Ja Rule and Murder, Inc., and Kenneth Supreme McGriff, who was affiliated with Murder, Inc., had his name thrown in the mix heavy. Rumors swirled about how this beef might have been behind the shooting, but it was never fully confirmed. Surviving that hit became a key moment in 50's life. He flipped the whole ordeal into motivation, turning the bullets into bars that fueled his rise to the top. His story of survival became legendary, and it's a core part of his identity in hip-hop. A hustler who faced death and bounced back, stronger than ever. This incident not only changed 50's life, but also etched his resilience and survival into the fabric of hip-hop history. Before that, Baum had already been in the trenches, tied to all kinds of dirt like robberies, murder for hire, and more. But you know how this life ends. By June 2000, Hamo caught that karma back. They say it was part of that never-ending beef in the underworld. Brooklyn stayed beefing, and his name got caught up with Damian World Hardy and the CMB fam. Retaliation moves, all them gang wars. You either win or you end up a memory. Hamo's life ended the way a lot of them do, shot dead in the streets. Just another casualty of this cold game. Eventually, the law ran down on everybody who was in the mix with Daryl Baum's crew. The feds was on their necks, and the main cat they really had their sights on was Kenneth Supreme McGriff, a boss in the streets. Dude was tied up in all types of wild moves, drug slinging, murder for hire, and straight racketeering. The FBI and HSI weren't playing. They led the charge to break down the whole operation, and it was all orchestrated by United States District Judge Frederick Block. The feds came down heavy, showing they wasn't about to let that gang activity rock like that. This whole situation didn't just stay in the streets, it spilled over into the culture. When Baum got linked to the 50 Cent shooting, it turned into one of the most infamous moments in hip hop. The streets and the music was always connected, but this took it to another level. That real life street drama became the blueprint for a lot of gangster rap, where the lines between what's real and what's for entertainment got blurry. This whole saga left its mark on the music industry. The drama, the beef, the shootouts, it all influenced the way stories were told in hip hop. Baum's legacy is still echoed in the streets, tied to Supreme, 50 Cent, and the whole BK crime wave of the late 90s. Damian Hardy was born November 3rd, 1974, out in the heart of Brooklyn. He was raised in that gritty, legendary Bedford-Stuyvesant section. Homie went to Queen of All Saints Elementary over in Fort Greene.
So he been running them Brooklyn blocks since young. Now word on the street, the name World came from his peoples, comparing him to the baller Lloyd World Be Free, who switched up his name back in the day cause his game was that wild. World ain't the only one in his fam with a heavy alias. His big bro, Myron Hardy, they called him Wise. Both of them was moving different, real standout types. They went to Bishop Laughlin Memorial High, that Roman Catholic spot that was all about preparing cats for college life. But check this, Laughlin wasn't just a regular school. It got history in the streets and in the game. That joint birthed legends like Mark Jackson, NBA Rookie of the Year, and Biggie Smalls. So, from playing the courts to running the streets, World was destined for that Brooklyn legacy. Different lanes, but still heavy in the game. Back in 91, Damian World Hardy and his brother Myron Wise Hardy formed the Cash Money Brothers, a real street-certified drug operation that took over the Lafayette Gardens housing projects in Bed-Stuy, Brooklyn. This spot was home to over 2,600 heads with seven towers, each stacking like 13 stories high. It was a fortress for the streets, and CMB made it the base of their whole operation. World and Wise wasn't no small timers. They muscled out the OGs, running crack sales in the projects and set up shop like bosses. But like any heavy in the game, it ain't take long for the heat to come down. By 93, Damian caught a case, convicted on weapons charges and witness tampering. Dude was out here wildin', accused of popping shots at narcs and allegedly ordering hits on witnesses snitching on CMB members. That landed him 2 to 4 years in state pen. The streets was watching and they moved different after that, but World and CMB was already cemented as serious players in the Brooklyn drug game. After World got out in April 96, he ain't waste time getting back in the mix. By 98, he was already on some real street beef. The story goes like this. Damian Hardy got kicked out of a Brooklyn roller skating rink by a bouncer named Michael Colin. World took that as disrespect. And when you in the game like he was, disrespect ain't ever fly. So in a 99, he had Colin murked by another CMB member as payback. Now, just when things was heating up, World's brother Myron Wise Hardy got caught in a serious situation. On June 12th, the 99, Myron was gunned down in Lafayette Gardens over some territory drama by Rumel Davis, nephew of Ivory Davis, who ran the rival Davis crew. This hit on Myron had the streets buzzing. World, who was locked up at the time of his brother's death, wasn't gonna let that slide. That kicked off a whole killing spree. World was out for blood. On June 15th, just a few days later, CMB member Dwayne Myers caught Jared Mackins, a dude tied to the Davis gang, and smoked him in the same building where Myron got hit. Word on the block was Mackins gave Rommel Davis the burner that took out Myron, so Myers handled it accordingly. That beef between CMB and the Davis crew turned into a real war zone, and things got way more out of hand after that. Rommel dipped out of NYC after the heat got too real, but he didn't stay low for long. They finally caught him slipping in North Carolina in 2001. After he got extradited back to the city, the judge hit him with 28 years. That's a long stretch. Now let's talk about Daryl Hamo Baum. On June 10th, 2000, he got hit up, shot right in the back of the dome after he was pressing Edward Taz Cook, a CMB soldier, to move weight for him. Eric Moore, another CMB member, pulled the trigger right on the corner of Quincy and Marcy in front of the whole block. Zara Sarkashan, another homie from the crew, was the getaway driver. Baum's sister, Zakia, said he got lured to that corner by a shorty he knew. After he caught those bullets, they rushed him to Kings County Hospital, but he was gone about 10 hours later. In a real show of loyalty, heavyweight champ Mike Tyson, Baum's day one, covered his funeral costs. Crazy thing is, just 6 months before that, he was released from a 13-year bid and was already looking to link up with Ivory Davis for business. Word on the street is that Tyson put a 50K hit on Damian Hardy after they took out his boy, Daryl Hamo Baum. But Hardy wasn't just sitting back. He caught wind of that hit and flipped the script, trying to put a hit on Tyson too. Then, on August 1st, things got messy. Hardy's crew sent a shooter to take out James Hamilton, one of Ivory Davis's boys, right inside his seafood spot in Brooklyn. No mercy. Fast forward to August 10th around 4 a.m. Eric Ebay Moore from the CMB rolled up and let off shots, hit Ivory Davis twice in the back while he was chilling in his Range Rover parked outside the now closed Club Envy in Soho. Davis tried to bounce, ended up crashing into Johan Kametz, a 38-year-old award-winning filmmaker, as he was crossing the street. That crash was wild. Kametz lost a leg, and the SUV flipped over after slamming into a traffic pole. Kametz didn't make it after they rushed him to St. Vincent's. Ivory Davis was pronounced dead right at the crash scene. No chance to recover. Davis, he was no stranger to the streets. Just last July, he got popped for putting hands on a club owner in Brooklyn. This dude had been shot twice before, including 6 months back outside the tunnel in Manhattan. His rap sheet was thick too. Drugs, attempted murder, and he even did time for armed robbery back in 2001. Meanwhile, in the wild world of the CMB, Eric Moore was out here working for the big boss, Kenneth Supreme McGriff, and was supposedly sent to take out Troy Singleton. They hit Singleton up while he was bouncing out of a Queens nightclub on July 12, 2002. Dude got shot multiple times in the head and back. And if that ain't enough, Damian Hardy and his crew, including James Sessoms, Isheen Campbell, and Key Wayne Jones, got charged for trying to rob and kidnap Ashbuddin Shakur. Police found Shakur all tied up and blindfolded in a Brooklyn spot that the CMB ran, and they even snagged a loaded AK-47 while they were at it. Meanwhile, Damian Hardy started getting cozy with Kimberly Jones in 2002. They go way back to first grade, but she had previously been with his bro, Myron. But during their time together, Hardy allegedly put hands with Jones, so much so that she had to get some cosmetic work done. They were living it up in a mansion in Jersey, and she even copped him a Range Rover. Irony hit hard when Ivory Davis, the Hardy's longtime rival, showed up as her love interest in a music video for a hit track from her crew, Junior Mafia. Fast forward to September 2003, Hardy got into a shootout with 50 Cent security outside a Doubletree hotel in Jersey. This beef went back to earlier that year when Hardy confronted Curtis over some disrespect he threw at Jones during an interview on Hot 97. By the time Kimberly Jones and Damian Hardy called it quits in 2004, they were already engaged. But it wasn't all love and sunshine. In 2004, Hardy hit up Wendy Williams' show, talking about his past with Jones and addressing wild conspiracy theories aimed at him. Then it all came crashing down. On August 15, 2004, after a four-month spiritual journey in the Middle East, Hardy touched down at JFK and got bagged by the NYPD, FBI, and a few other agencies. He'd been arrested twice during his travels, once in Morocco and again in Jordan for speaking out against the king. Fast forward to July 19th, 2005, and they dropped a federal indictment on him and 12 other CMB homies for racketeering and drug trafficking. It started with one count of conspiracy to move weight, but by 2008, they hit him with a superseding indictment that slapped him with 26 counts. Everything from narcotics trafficking to racketeering and 6 murders tied to the game. During this crazy time, Damian Hardy switched his name to Issa Jabril Sessoms. He got locked up in June 2005, just before those July indictments hit, and went to trial in September 2006. The verdict came down quick, and he was found guilty the next month. Hardy was chilling at the Metropolitan Detention Center in Brooklyn until August 2011, when they sentenced him to a hefty 35 years. After that, they shipped him off to the max security joint, Big Sandy, out in Kentucky. While he was locked up at the Met, things got real when he stabbed another inmate. Meanwhile, his boy Abu Bakr Rahim faced trial in June 2008 for driving the getaway car in the murders of James Hamilton back in August 2000 and Tyrone Baum in July 2003. During the trial, Hardy's boy, Shelby Henderson, flipped and became a government witness. He dropped some serious info, saying that Hamilton's murder was all about Edward Cook trying to take out the competition in the numbers game. He even claimed that Cook blamed both the Baum brothers for his pop's death. Henderson also ratted about a party at Hardy's mom's crib, celebrating the hit on Ivory Davis. While everyone was kicking it, they started talking about Merck and Mike Tyson, but Henderson was like, "Nah, that ain't it." Now here's where it gets wild. Hardy was deemed unfit to stand trial because they diagnosed him with schizophrenia, but the dude refused to take his meds. Fast forward to 2013, a 3-judge panel was like, "Nah, you gotta take those antipsychotics so we can see if you're good to go." This decision came after he was causing all kinds of chaos in the joint, assaulting guards and inmates alike. While locked up at a federal prison hospital in Springfield, Missouri, Hardy even stuffed a tube of toothpaste with urine to throw at the guards. The death penalty was lurking over both Hardy and Granton ever since then. Attorney General Michael Mukasey greenlit that mess back in 2007. But things flipped when Eric Holder, the U.S. Attorney General under Obama, came through and reversed that decision on May 29, 2014, taking the lethal injection threat off the table for them, too. Now, Hardy was out here hustling for funds, not just from his ex, Kimberly Jones, but also from her rival, the Brooklyn Queen, Foxy Brown. He was trying to lock down the legendary Benjamin Braffman as his lawyer, the dude who's got a track record defending heavyweights like Jay-Z, Michael Jackson, and even mob boss Sammy the Bull. Braffman had already helped Diddy beat the rap in a gun case back in 2001. Fast forward to April 1st, 2015, nearly a decade after his indictment. Hardy's federal drug trafficking trial kicked off. He was backed by David Runca, a seasoned vet with 30 years in the game who had tackled 15 capital cases. David Runca has repped some heavyweights like drug kingpin Kenneth McGriff and mobster Martin Taxetta. His wife, Jean Barrett, was also in the ring as co-counsel. All thanks to Judge Frederick Block laying down that order, Hardy was stuck on that antipsychotic haloperidol, getting hit with mad meds through the whole trial. According to snitch testimony, heavyweight champ Mike Tyson and his dude Muhammad Noor put a $50,000 hit on Hardy and Cook after the murder of Tyson's childhood homie and bodyguard Daryl Baum back in June 2000. Tyson even dedicated a quick 38-second knockout of contender Lou Savarese to Baum. Tyson never faced charges for that alleged hit. Hardy found out about the hit on him and tried to flip the script, ordering a hit on Tyson instead. Shelby from the Cash Money Brothers didn't want to take out Tyson because they were both Muslims. They even had eyes on Tyson, but when he got spotted chilling in a Range Rover near the Bedford Atlantic Army Men's Shelter in Crown Heights, they pulled back on the plan. Bryant said Cook was trying to get Aziz, who was known for rolling around with a shotgun in a suitcase, to take out Tyson right there on the spot. But it don't stop there. Hardy was scheming on the low, targeting music industry parties and sending CMB members to hit those spots to rob rappers who were in the mix. Dwayne Thor Myers testified about this wild beef between Hardy and the dude running a medical spot in Brooklyn. Hardy was trying to rope him into some shady insurance scam, and when dude laughed at him, he got followed all the way to Bushwick and shot right in the street. You got Cook and Bryant deciding to snitch on Hardy after they got busted at JFK with 8 kilos of that white. Bryant got kicked out of CMB after it came out he was using. And to add salt to the wound, he found out while he was locked up, Hardy was smashing his girl in a three-way. Moore got popped on July 18th, 2005, just a day before they dropped the initial indictments on CMB. He survived a headshot back in 2003 when him and his boys got ambushed in an elevator in Coney Island. Fast forward to April 29th, 2015, when both Hardy and Moore were found guilty on all charges. Racketeering, kidnapping, narcotics trafficking, and they caught 6 bodies too. On May 11th, families of the victims showed up to lay down their statements at the sentencing. In the end, both Hardy and Moore were hit with 6 life sentences, and they still locked up serving time for their wild choices. Tyron Tata Moore, OGs running the streets would always say Tata was one of the smallest dudes on the block, but had the most heart. Certified G, ask anybody in Queens and Brooklyn, Tata, South Jamaican legend, 105 and Inwood. Now, if you was to make a list of the most feared goons to come out of Queens, you won't get too far on that list before you start checking off the name of Tyron Tata Moore. When we talk about straight shooters, cats who really lived that life, there's some names that rings out above the rest. We always debating whose life deserves a movie. This one right here, straight blockbuster material, packed with everything, murder charges, shootouts with the police, hostage situations, all that. This dude's name been tied to 2 of the most iconic shootings in hip-hop, and at one point, he was even accused of catching a body himself. Just to show y'all how wild his story is, he was once rumored to have taken out the DJ for the legendary Run DMC. Yeah, Jam Master J. But on the flip, dude also got a kid with a shorty who was part of one of the first pioneering female rap crews. So, we talking about him being connected to 2 legendary rap groups, Run DMC and Salt-N-Pepa. Based on all that's been written and talked about when it comes to Tyron Tata Moore, it's clear dude was wildin' way before his name hit the papers. But as far as what's on record, his first real run-in with the law went down in 88 when he got slapped with his first murder charge. Now, they ain't put out too many details on that one, but the New York Post labeled him a reputed gang runner at the time. Charges got dropped though, so that was his first W. Fast forward 5 years later to 93, and my man was back in the mix, caught up in another murder charge, this time for a dude named Latif Leach, who the streets knew as a dealer. The word is, some type of beef went down at a gas station in Ozone Park, and Latif's whip ended up getting lit up with bullets. That case ain't like the one back in the 88 though, cause this one stuck around for a couple of years. But when it finally hit trial, Tata ain't fold. He took it all the way to court, beat them charges, and came out 2-0 against the state. All right, so after beating 2 of the biggest charges you could ever catch, the 2000s came knocking. And right around May of that year, the rap game would get hit with one of its wildest moments. 50 Cent, an up-and-coming artist at the time, got shot 9 times. Now, when this went down, the streets already knew 50 had beef with Murder, Inc., who was rolling with Queens' biggest drug lord, Kenneth Supreme McGriff. And guess who was tight with Supreme? None other than Tyron, Tata Moore. Their connection was so deep that folks in the hood started whispering Tata's name as one of the shooters in the hit on 50. This wasn't just street talk either. 50 even addressed it himself on his classic mixtape, Guess Who's Back, taking shots at the whole situation and letting people know what time it was. Believe it or not, all that wildness I mentioned before wasn't even the craziest thing Tata got mixed up in. Fast forward to August 29th, 2003, and Brew found himself in some real movie-type drama, a straight-up two-hour hostage situation. Let me break it down. NYPD pulled up looking to grill him about the shooting of a NYPD captain, and you know Tata wasn't trying to hear that. With his back against the wall, he did what he felt he had to do, ended up kidnapping his own nephew, plus a homegirl of his and her 6-year-old. Imagine that, NYPD swarming outside, tension heavy in the air, and dude holding down his own fam inside. Crazy part? Nobody got hurt. It ended as peaceful as a hostage situation could end, but it showed just how far Tata was willing to go to stay out of them cuffs. He eventually skated on the charges for the police captain shooting, but he still had to face them consequences for the whole hostage drama. Man paid his dues to society, but things ain't slow down for him. Fast forward to December 2004, and life hit different again. This time, it wasn't Tata and the crosshairs. It was his brother, Troy Moore. They were outside Club LQ in Manhattan when it popped off. Troy got shot, but it was his homie William Clark who didn't make it out alive that night. The streets was buzzing. NYPD was looking at the whole thing, wondering if it was some kind of retaliation for that Murder, Inc. beef, or maybe even tied to the 50 Cent shooting. But, like always, authorities couldn't lock down no real connection. That right there was the last time Tata's name really hit the headlines when it came to anything criminal. Even though Tata laid low after all that street drama, his name still popped up in a whole different lane. On October 14th, 2007, VH1 dropped The Salt and Peppa Show, starring Cheryl Salt James and Sandra Peppa Denton. Now Peppa, who, like I said, is Tata's baby mama and mother to his son, Tyron Denton Jr., had ties to some real hustlers, with folks even speculating at one point that her son might have been fathered by Carl Smitty Smith, a Houston gangster. Even though Tata's name ain't really come up heavy on the show, it did pop up occasionally. Then later, when Peppa and Tyron Jr. moved on to growing up hip-hop, his name got mentioned more, giving people a peek into that old connection. But here's the thing. Come 2022, Tata would pass away, sparking mad speculation about what really happened. People were talking about all kinds of things, some saying he OD'd by accident, others claiming he passed from natural causes. Just like in life, where rumors and allegations followed him, even his death came with the same cloud of mystery. But for someone who was deep in the streets, Tata didn't go out by the gun, like most would expect. Peter Pete Hsu, New York City's greatest party promoter. A lot of people don't really know who Peter Hsu is, but he's one of the greatest party promoters ever to hail from New York City. He was responsible for many big parties at the time that brought music, sports, and street icons together in one building. Peter Hsu was born on April 19, 1959 in the Bronx. He grew up in the Simpson area of the South Bronx. South Bronx, musically around the mid-late 80s, was known for BDP Boogie Down Productions. The Bronx as a whole was in bad shape for a long time, but the birth of hip-hop began in that borough on August 11, 1973, when DJ Kool Herc scratched two copies of Sex Machine by James Brown. Peter came from a Chinese father and an African-American mother. His features showed his Asian side more, but when he spoke, his strong Bronx accent and fast speech shocked whoever didn't know him. South Bronx had everything. Drugs, prostitutes, stick-up kids, kidnappers, the whole nine. He grew up with a love for basketball, playing for his school teams. Before being kicked out of every high school in the Bronx between 1974 to 78 for cutting class, bad behavior, the usual, Peter attended Stevenson, Monroe, and Evander, just to name a few. Always a hustler, he started off selling joints on the corner, about 700 of them, which put $700 in his pocket each week. This carried on throughout college. In 1979, he enrolled at Manhattan City College and played basketball for them. He's wearing number 10. Around the early 1980s, while people were getting their hustle on and made large amounts of money, Peter and his group were the ones taking that money from them with force. His father passed away around that time, so he felt the need to become a man and take care of his mother. In 1984, he was arrested for armed robbery and sent to jail for 4 years. He was released in 1988. His incarceration was served during the height of the crack epidemic. When he came home, all of his friends had quit their day jobs and thought he was going to lead them back into robbing people for money. But he said he was done with that life. Coming home, determined not to get back into the stick-up game, on his mother's advice, he went out and got a job. He began working for a telephone company and was very popular amongst his colleagues. There was a man in his job. If I say what he was, I'm gonna lose my account, y'all can figure that out, but the man at his job didn't like Peter for whatever reason and tried to get him fired. Peter had to check in with his parole officer, and instead of using the phone in the break room, he used the phone at his desk to call her. The man overheard the convo. Turns out when Peter filled out his job application, he didn't check off the box that said he was a felon, because he knew if he did, he'd be jobless and get violated by his PO. The man snitched on him to the boss, and he was approached by the supervisor, only to get fired. The manager tried to vouch for him by saying how much of a good job he was doing, but the supervisor didn't care. He had to go. His PO already contacted his mother about what happened, and on the way home he cried and wanted to drive off the bridge. Peter got home, looked at his mother, and she already knew what was about to happen. He told her that he tried it her way, and he'll never work for anybody again in his life. Around the time this was happening, his birthday was coming up and had got an early gift that he stashed in his closet from a friend. The night he got fired, a smell came from the closet. He opened it and it was a kilo of cocaine. He called the friend who gifted him the kilo and was instructed on how to cook it up into crack. Although he told his friends he wasn't going to get into the crack business. He messed up the batch and the kilo dissolved as he was trying to cook it up. After that, he got a pro cook. Peter decided that instead of selling crack, he was just going to sell cocaine and heroin, since he knew people that could buy them in high quantities. His friends wanted to throw him a party, so they came up with a plan to host the biggest party of the year, a black tie affair. Peter rented out a hotel ballroom that could hold up to 2,000 people, but still chose to hand out 30,000 flyers. Along with that, he advertised on the radio, and his party was the place to be. Everyone in New York City heard about his party, and they all came out to support him and have a good time. Mike Tyson, Charles Oakley, Keith Sweat, Mary J. Blige, Jodeci, Intouch, Puff, Salt-N-Pepa, and many more came out to his parties. Every party he had, they were there. Many R&B and other hip-hop artists gained popularity points by performing at his parties. Out of love, they performed for free because the promotion was free just by being there. Puff was one of the many to benefit from these parties, as well as Keith Sweat. After realizing the success his birthday party had, he chose to throw one every month. A Peter Shoe party was in constant demand. While throwing the parties, he still had his feet in the drug game. His brother-in-law knew the connect down in Miami, and he could get the work there at a decent price. Coke value in the street was about $19,000, but he'd sell it for $15,000, $16,000. Heroin was real money, though. Coke is good money, but dope is unbelievable money. Peter began traveling all over with his team. Los Angeles, Las Vegas, Miami, Baltimore, the islands, wherever money could be made. In the midst of all that, he started having kids of his own, but he needed the money to take care of them. His bread and butter was dealing in Baltimore. He could push a lot of weight down there, and he knew his way around as if it were New York. He was moving 6 to 8 keys a week and made $80,000 off of each key. Sometimes he would carry over $500,000 in bags by himself. The money became so much, he and his team would count $15 million in cash by hand. No money machine. And if one of them messed the count up, they would have to empty out the bags and start all over. Peter would sponsor basketball games for the kids and community in Harlem at Rucker Park. He had his own team called Take No Prisoners and handed out thousands of t-shirts to everybody in the stands so the opponents could see. This is where Above the Rim was inspired from. Peter played in these games also. He had an altercation with a coach who happened to be a dyke, and she had told him to suck her dick. He told her watch her mouth, and she didn't. So he walked over and slapped her to the ground. Her friend had pulled out a gun on Peter, so he walks over to the dude with his shirt lifted up and tells him, go ahead, shoot. The dude got so scared Peter did that, so he runs off. The coach is still on the ground, and Peter smiles at her and says, you know you dead right. After the game, Peter had got 25 cars full of dudes, 4 in each car, to go out and find the guy who pulled the gun out on him and to also find the coach. Over 100 dudes going around the city looking for them. They got stopped by the TNT, Tactical Narcotics Team. Peter had a Desert Eagle in his hand but ditched it and ran off. 37 of his guys got apprehended, and his lawyer called him saying that he had to bail them out, which he did, spent $500,000. That night, Peter went to his apartment in Manhattan, and the police knocked on his door. No one knew where he lived, so he was surprised to see them there. The coach had family members in the forest. The police told him if she ends up dead, he's going to jail. Peter answered and said, she better not ever come back to Harlem again, and shut the door right in their faces. She never came back to Harlem again. Peter was so deep in the game one night, a guy got shot in a park who fit the description of Peter Black and Asian. And Domencio, who he was good friends with, called Peter's mother crying and telling her, Peter is dead and I'm gonna find out who did it. I'ma get him. Domencio had sent Peter's mother in a frenzy. She and his sister went to one hospital, and Peter's girlfriend went to another hospital. Meanwhile, Peter was in Baltimore counting millions and not answering his beeper. Peter ended up contacting his family, and his mother begged him to get out the game. He agreed and told her one more year and he's done for good. He meant it. More popular he got, more famous figures showed their faces at his events. Wesley Snipes, Woody Harrelson, Chaka Khan, Robert De Niro, and Tupac were all there. Heavy D was also a close friend of Peter too. Heavy said, I'll never go to a party unless it's a Peter Shoe party. He had genuine love for Peter. Keith Sweat was very close to Peter, and Keith had issues with Alpo. Peter told Alpo, if you touch Keith, I will kill you, and Alpo left Keith alone. Peter was respected, but feared, and he meant business. Suge Knight had the impression that New Yorkers were soft because of who we had as executives running the business. Peter turned that around quick. Peter wasn't afraid of anyone but God. Suge respected him after their altercation and asked Peter if he could manage Death Row East along with Chaz, who was 50 Cent's old manager and a bank robber from Queens in the 70s. Peter tried to wash his money and go legit. He met Madonna at a nightclub, beginning an affair between the two. He used to take her to Rucker Park. They traveled together on private jets. Peter did anything to make sure he could get what he wanted, and she knew what he was doing. Peter was washing $10 million a month through Madonna. She loved him, he didn't love her. She went as far as to say she wanted his babies. When they first met, he said, I like my women black like my coffee. Even though he was joking, she should have known. Peter up and left her. She was upset, so she had got an old mob lady named Arline Brickman to help set him up with the feds. This old lady was a 65-year-old informant for the FBI, working with them for years. Peter eventually got set up with feds and went to Long Island to meet up with whoever he was supposed to be dealing with that night. Instead, he was approached by 30 cars full of federal agents and Madonna nowhere to be found. Peter went to trial and it led to two hung juries. His lawyer made him say that he was in love with her, so that's why she did what she did. It didn't work. The feds also tried to cut him a deal, which would have led to him serving 5 years, but the charges leading up were adding more. Peter didn't snitch on anyone and took his sentence on the chin. He got hit with 24 years and 8 months. He ended up serving only 21 years, missing out on his kids' lives and the rest of his mother's, who passed away not too long ago when he got out. Rest in peace. Now that he's out and back on his feet, he has a couple projects he's working on right now. He also released his autobiography. It's a must-read for in-depth information on what I covered. And he has Madonna's panties that she sent him on the plane, which he is auctioning for $25 million. It has her DNA on it also, confirmed. Came with a nice little note, too. Enjoy your life, be happy, be productive, and be careful who you invite in your circle. Back in the 80s and 90s, plenty of street cats didn't step foot in Queens without feeling that mix of fear and respect for Kenneth Supreme McGriff and his ruthless crew, the Supreme Team. Everybody knew not to cross them. Small-time hustlers were shaking in their boots. But there was this one dude who didn't flinch, Troy Singleton, better known as Big Nose Troy. In a time when Queens was home to heavy hitters like Prince, 50 Cent, and Fat Cat Nichols, Troy was his own man, not giving a damn about the old guard's reputation. He rolled tight with legends like Prodigy from Mobb Deep and his right-hand man, E. Moneybags. Young and fearless, Big Nose Troy was out there making moves, involved in multiple robberies in Queens and the surrounding blocks, carving out his own legacy. That earned Big Nose Troy a rep as someone you definitely didn't want smoke with, but that tough guy act came back to haunt him. After Troy spotted one of the Supreme Team's names on them docs that linked him to a double hit, him and his bro, E. Moneybags, declared all-out war on the Supreme Team. They spent months hunting down and slapping up anyone connected to those cats. That was a bold move, no doubt. Troy put hands on some of Supreme's closest homies like Irv Gotti and Ron Gunner Robinson, and it wasn't long before Supreme put a price on his head. That bounty finally caught up to him in October 2001 when he got brutally executed outside Club Van Wyck on Liberty Avenue in South Jamaica, Queens. Let me break it down for y'all about Big Nose Troy and how he threw down against the Supreme Team. This dude was born in Queens back in '68, and trust, he wasn't just some random. He was a straight-up OG legend in the game. While you might hear more about heavyweights like Kenneth McGriff, 50 Cent, or Fat Cat, Troy had a rep that hit hard on the streets. Now, there ain't much public info on him, and the stories about his early days are all over the place. But one thing's for sure, Troy never shied away from a fight. He rolled with a new crew of heavy hitters who didn't flinch at the old guard's rep. His fearless attitude led him to step up to Supreme and his squad. And that's where the real chaos kicked off, setting the stage for a war that would come with heavy consequences. Big Nose Troy was dealing with sickle cell anemia, which ain't no joke, but that didn't stop him from grinding. He formed a real tight bond with Prodigy from Mobb Deep, both struggling with the same health issues. Whenever Prodigy was laid up in the hospital, you could count on Troy to roll through, bringing him that Red Lobster to lift his spirits. That's loyalty right there, fam. Then you got Eric Smith, AKA Moneybags, Troy's right-hand man since day one. These two were partners in crime, hitting up all kinds of stick-ups in Jamaica and the surrounding blocks. But things took a wild turn when E. Moneybags accidentally hit Black just while trying to take out Supreme outside the Jamaica Coliseum Mall back in 99. That just fueled the fire, and over the years, Big News Troy and E. Moneybags became some of the Supreme team's biggest ops. And let me tell you, that beef didn't end well for either side. Troy wasn't just a ride or die for Moneybags, who had mad beef with Supreme and his crew. He had his own reasons to want the Supreme team taken down too. Most cats know why Moneybags had it out for him, but if you don't, let me break it down for you real quick. See, before Supreme got locked up for life, he was hustling tagged cars through this shorty named Z. E. Moneybags was trying to cop a whip, so he threw down an $11,000 deposit with Z for one of those tagged rides. But when it came time to finalize the deal, E switched it up, deciding he wanted that cash to go towards a brand new Lincoln Navigator instead of copping one of Supreme's hot cars. When E. Moneybags rolled up on Supreme for that refund, he got treated like a goofy, and Supreme refused to give him back his bread. That right there sparked a legendary beef that ended with the tragic accidental death of Black just back in 99. But for Big Nose Troy, his beef with the Supreme team had a whole different backstory. In July 95, there was this basketball tournament called the Peace Tournament out in Baisley Pond Park, South Jamaica, Queens. They held it to honor two men who got taken out by a police officer back in December 94. The whole block was out there, about 300 heads from the Baisley Projects cheering on the games. But then tragedy struck. Just 5 minutes into the second half, shots rang out on the court, turning a celebration into chaos. Nobody knew who popped off first, but when the smoke cleared, two spectators were dead and a bunch of folks were injured. The fallen were Pierre Mitchell and Jamal Adams. Even though the cops had a tough time pinning down who was involved in that shootout, confirmed to be drug-related, Troy ended up getting fingered in a lineup at the 113th precinct and got hit with second-degree murder charges. One major thing to keep in mind about that incident is that the Baisley Park projects were known as turf for Supreme. So Troy making moves like that on his court was a real bad look. When the Peace Tournament popped off, all that chaos was laid out by Ethan Brown in his book, Queens Reign Supreme, back in 2010. But new details about Troy just came to light. As Big Nose Troy was getting bagged for that shootout, it said a Supreme team member dropped a statement against him. Word on the street is James Bimmy Antony was also set to sign an affidavit and testify against Troy. But Bimmy didn't end up testifying, and Troy walked free. Still, he took that ratting situation real personal, especially after what went down with E. Moneybags getting jacked out of his cash and that double hit situation. That heat fueled Troy's rage against Supreme's crew. And with all that tension, he and E. Moneybags decided to do the unthinkable and declare war on the Supreme team. When I say war, I mean war. Anyone rolling with the Supreme team became an enemy straight up. Big Nose Troy and E. Moneybags were out there in Queens, pistol whipping, smacking, and slapping every dude linked to Supreme. They were stoking that fire, knowing this beef was gonna end in tragedy. Troy hated Supreme so much he was out here stalking his ops outside Universal Records, running down on them and slapping the dog shit out of them right on Broadway, the busiest street in NYC. You'd think that would be enough to get his anger off his chest, but nope. Troy took it up a notch. He hit Supreme where it really hurt, going after his crew over at Murder, Inc. During his rampage, he rolled up on Ja Rule's manager, Ron Gunner Robinson, and smacked him around. Around the same time, Troy and Nathan Green Eyes Bourne, another OG from the streets, tracked down Irv Gotti, one of Supreme's right-hand men, and gave him a beatdown too. By 2001, Supreme had enough of Troy's antics and decided to hit back hard. He called up Emmanuel Dog Mosley, a member of his crew, to deal with Troy once and for all. According to Dog Mosley's testimony, Supreme hit him up to put together a squad of hitmen to take out E Moneybags and Big Nose Troy, dropping a $50,000 bounty on their heads. In Supreme's eyes, E Moneybags had to go for what he did to Black Just, and Troy had to be put down for all that chaos he caused at the peace tournament and beyond. So in Dog's own words, he assembled a crew to get the job done. But unfortunately for E Moneybags, he was the first target they caught. They found him in his whip, and July 2001 was the end of the line for him. Then, on October 28th, Mosley's hit squad rolled up on Troy outside a club on Liberty Avenue in South Jamaica while he was heading back to his ride. They lit him up, hitting him 8 times. Troy didn't stand a chance. For months after taking out Troy, Mosley and his crew were still looking for Green Eyes Born, but never managed to find him. The hits on Troy and E Moneybags played a major role in Supreme getting locked up for life in 2007. That'll wrap up this video, my G's. I appreciate y'all tuning in. I need y'all hop in the comment section and give me some names of dudes who were known in streets for letting they gun go off, legendary hood status and such, so I can bring their story to light. Don't forget to hit them like and subscribe buttons so y'all get notified every time we drop. Peace and blessings.
This shit is wicked, you know these mean streets.